Those of you who have seen the museum's new exhibit on JFK and World War II have seen some remarkable artifacts, ranging from JFK's dog tags to the actual coconut on which he carved the message that led to the rescue of PT-109's crew. You've seen some remarkable documents, a letter JFK wrote to his parents that I saw George Stevens Jr. reading, a letter from World War II. JFK's own very personal scrapbook of photographs of him and his buddies in the Solomon Islands. People put together these black and white images because all that they said about World War II, the images of battles and the images of men. We think of World War II in black and white. But in fact, during World War II, the United States Army pulled together an extraordinary roster of Hollywood veterans, led by George Stevens, who later directed such Academy Award-winning films as A Place in the Sun and Giant. They were pulled together to go to the front lines in Europe and film in color the Normandy invasion, the Battle of the Bulge, the horrors of the concentration camps, and the liberation of Paris. About a decade ago, George Stevens' son, George Stevens Jr., who was director of the Motion Picture Service of the USIA under President Kennedy, took his father's remarkable World War II footage and produced the film that you will see tonight, George Stevens, D-Day to Berlin. The film won 3 Emmys, and you can't take your eyes off of it. After we show it, George Stevens Jr., long a friend of this library, somebody who gave great thought to what this library should be, and producer of the documentary Years of Lightning, Day of Drums, about President Kennedy, will join in a conversation with Mark Feeney, a reporter, editor, and reviewer of the Boston Globe, and the author of, dare I say this name here, Nixon at the Movies, a book about belief. Ladies and gentlemen, George Stevens, D-Day to Berlin.
This was World War II. And this is how we remember it. On film, black and white motion picture film. And this is the way it really looked. This is the way it looked to those who were there. This is unique color film, the most comprehensive color record of the war in Europe.
My father was George Stevens, the film director. He started out as a cameraman, and before the war, he directed films like Alice Adams with Katharine Hepburn, Gunga Din, and Swing Time with Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers. He left Hollywood in 1942 to serve in the Army Signal Corps, and he was assigned by General Eisenhower to organize the motion picture coverage of the war in Europe. His special coverage unit shot 35mm black and white film, and much of it became the record by which we remember the war. He also took along his own 16mm camera and some Kodachrome film. And with it, he and the men who traveled in his Jeep shot a kind of personal diary. And from time to time, he sent the film home in these boxes to our house near Toluca Lake in North Hollywood. After the war, the color film ended up in a storeroom where my father kept the things that were important to him. For decades, these boxes of film remained there, unexamined, until after his death. You are about to see the war the way my father and his colleagues saw it, and to hear their recollections of those times when each day was an adventure and hopes for the world ran high. We begin in London in 1944, where he assembled the team which came to be known as the Stevens Irregulars.
These are men way past military age. We're all rather pacifistic. Not pacifistic when it came to dealing with studio heads or perhaps in a brawl in a nightclub. But all very liberal men, one and all, they gave up very lucrative and very prestigious careers and went right into the army.
As D-Day approached, Lieutenant Colonel Stevens had beside him a team of professionals. The special coverage unit of the Allied Expeditionary Force. Among them, William Saroyan, the playwright. Holly Morse, assistant director from the Roach Studios. Bill Hamilton, sound man from Columbia Studios. Novelist, screenwriter, Irwin Shaw. Writer, Ivan Moffat. And cameramen, Ken Marthy, Jack Muth, Dick Kent, and William Meller. On D-Day, they would fan out among the Allied armies to cover the greatest seaborne invasion in history. In the dawn of the 6th of June, 1944, the armada of the Allied nations set forth across the English Channel and drew near the heavily fortified beaches of occupied France. With the same camera that he used for home movies on Gunga Din, my father began his color film diary. The flagship Belfast was designated to fire the first volley of the invasion. He saw the captain read to his men assembled on the deck from Shakespeare, Henry V. We few, we happy few, we band of brothers, for he today who sheds his blood with me shall be my brother.
D-Day, landing time for the first beachhead boats. Now Signal Corps cameras catch the full drama of the fateful hour.
The Allies had the advantage of surprise and put ashore 176,000 men in the first 24 hours. But the German resistance was fierce, and the Allies could not gain momentum. It became clear that long days and months of hard fighting lay ahead. It was the job of the special coverage unit to record what they saw.
Able to move anywhere in the war under special orders. But we were right at frontline action all the time. If things got too heavy, George would say, I think we ought to get out of here.
George felt very strong about the war. He knew what his mission was. He knew what the war was about. And he was very dedicated to the best motion picture coverage of this tremendous event.
The special coverage unit operated from a base camp between the two American beaches, Utah and Omaha, which were pumping men and material directly into combat.
The overwhelming impression was of this extraordinary logistical power. I mean, the thousands and thousands and thousands of ships and hundreds of thousands of tons of material being unloaded 24 hours a day, pouring inland through every lane, across every road in that beachhead. And it was It was a sight that you would never dreamt of ever seeing. I mean, if there is victory, which of course we assume there would be, this is what victory is going to be made of. This amazing accumulation of stuff. These were truly the sinews of war.
The Stevens Irregulars dug in and set up their base of operations near the town of Carentan, in a field 1.5 kilometers from the German lines.
And now, Captain Glenn Miller. Thank you, Lieutenant Don Briggs, and good evening, everybody. Been a big week for our side. Over on the beaches of Normandy, our boys have fired the opening guns of the long-awaited drive to liberate the world. Now to get to a little music, here are the boys with their rocket gun version of Flying Home.
A famous sign up there that started off as New York and Paris on it, and gradually more and more was added on until finally at the bottom it was Shirley, 4,200 miles or something like that. Now Shirley was one of the boys' girlfriends, and I believe it was Chicago, but I couldn't be sure.
Highly professional, and we'd all been in the motion picture business for some time, and we'd all made many motion pictures, and we felt a little more qualified than some of the signal for corps cameramen. And we had cameramen like William Meller, who was an Academy Award winner, Joe Byrock, who is currently filming all the great shows of today. We were all experts in our field.
4 weeks after D-Day, they were summoned to a July 4th meeting of the High Command. British General Bernard Law Montgomery, Commander-in-Chief of the Allied Land Forces. General Omar Bradley, Commander of the American First Army, were there to decorate heroes of the invasion. General George Patton, with his pearl-handled revolver. Privately, the generals were worried about the Normandy campaign, fearing a stalemate on the narrow beachhead. But publicly, Montgomery radiated confidence.
The pace has been hot, and it was clear that someone would have to give ground sooner or later. It was equally clear that the Allied soldiers would see the thing through to the end and would never give up. And so the Germans have been forced to give ground, which is very right and proper. And today, the Allied armies fighting in Normandy have good grounds for solid satisfaction. Well done. Well done indeed.
Even as their army pulled back, the German landmines made the Allied advance dangerous.
The smell of death, I still smell once in a while at night. I wake up screaming in the middle of the night. The devastation was so extreme that I'll never outlive it.
George had an extraordinary sense of visualizing events and scenes. But these visual horrors and paradoxes gave him a great deal of insight into things that he'd never dreamt of before.
In an attempt to break out beyond their bridgehead, the Allies launched a massive air attack on the entrenched German garrison.
Wave after wave of bombers came in, and they were dropping their bombs on one particular little place, San Lo, and the concussion was just terrible, and this push went on for hours and hours, plane after plane.
The skies were full of bombers coming over everywhere you looked and dropping rows of bombs just ahead of where we were to clear out that area of Germans.
After weeks of bombardment and ground assault, the mighty German force had cracked. And for the Americans, this was their first look at the enemy.
You'd pick Germans out of foxholes and things like that who were just absolutely devastated by what had happened. They couldn't believe that. And they were just out of their minds. I'm sure it took them a long time to get back to reality.
This curious, unmistakable smell of leather and sweat. The Germans used a great deal of leather in their equipment. And there was a smell of unwashed uniforms and a peculiar smell one got used to and came to recognize wherever they had been among the prisoners of war.
Two 200,000 German prisoners were herded to the rear while the Allies raced forward. Where before, in the gritty battles in the hedgerows of Normandy, they measured a day's progress in yards, now, as liberators, they measured each day's advance in miles. The Allied armies were in competition, each hoping to be the first to Paris. My father decided to try to join the French armored division commanded by General Philippe Leclerc.
When he wanted to get around authority, he knew how to do it, usually just by remaining quiet. And he did that, I know, in Hollywood, and I think he did the same thing in the army. He was not a rebel, but he knew what he wanted, and he knew how to get it.
Mm-hmm. Authority granted, they joined Leclerc's forces to photograph the liberation of Paris. The 2nd French Armored Division entered the outskirts of the city at dawn on the 25th of August. And the Stevens Irregulars were with them.
The atmosphere was sort of halfway between a carnival and a bullfight. All the purpose of a war seemed to be coming true before your eyes.
George went right to the top. He went with the German command, the Guard Montparnasse. He filmed the taking of the surrender by General Leclerc.
Paris free again, and the beginning of the last act in its amazing story. The surrender of Lieutenant General von Choltitz, German commander of the Paris region. At a dingy office in Montparnasse Station, formal end of German rule.
Despite the surrender, sniper fire continued in the streets.
I think I ended up under a jeep, but Stevens was standing alone out in front. He looked down at me and said, you can't make any pictures from down there, you know. This is where the action is.
To achieve a ceasefire, captured German officers were dispatched across the city under white flags of truce to spread word of the surrender. Ivan Moffat spoke German and was detailed to escort one German officer.
We drove off with some difficulty through this enormous, angry, ferocious, rejoicing crowd which was in the Place de Rennes below. And he was spat at, and we were all drenched in spit. I had to sort of reassure him a bit that he wasn't going to be sort of lynched or something.
I remember my father saying that August the 25th, 1944, was the greatest day of his life. Americans turned a Bailey Bridge on its side to make a reviewing stand. General Bradley invited General de Gaulle to take the salute as the 28th Division marched down the Champs-Élysées.
Intoxicating, and one said at the time that no matter what would happen afterwards, nothing would ever exceed the emotional experience of the 25th of August, 1944, and nothing did.
Once the 28th Division passed the reviewing stand, they moved out of Paris to rejoin the American offensive. That day, Erwin Shaw bet my father that the war would be over by October. But ahead was the coldest winter in 20 years and history to be recorded. The Allies believed the enemy was weakening. But Hitler ordered the German army to counterattack. In what became known as the Battle of the Bulge, 200,000 German troops attacked the American positions. The Americans prevailed, but suffered 68,000 casualties. The Belgian countryside was devastated. The Americans were destined to spend one more Christmas away from home. As winter turned into spring, the Allies were once again fighting their way forward, moving into Germany. The next Allied objective was to cross the Rhine River. They mounted a massive air attack, sending 22,000 paratroopers in gliders to drop over the Rhine into Germany. The American First Army attacked on the ground, successfully crossing the Rhine and moving deeper into Germany. On the 11th of April, the special coverage unit came upon one of Germany's greatest and most secret installations. They found the largest underground factory in the world at Nordhausen. 40 miles of tunnels and passages. This was Nordhausen's product, the V-1 flying bomb. 8,000 of these terror weapons had been launched and rained destruction on England. These liquid fuel engines powered the new V-2 rocket, upon which Hitler was placing his last hopes for victory. And here, the Germans had developed the Messerschmitt 216, the world's first jet interceptor. These achievements of science were the product of slave labor. Czechs, Poles, Russians, Frenchmen, Belgians, and Italians forced to work underground.
Ken and I walked through one barracks. There was a man lying in a bed with another, two men in a bunk. And we said we were Americans, and this one man was very happy with a weak, sick face. And we interviewed some of the people there, and when we came back, that man had rolled over and died.
A week after leaving Nordhausen, they photographed the largest surrender of World War II. German Army Group B had been encircled and gave up 320,000 prisoners, including 25 generals.
Extraordinary to see them all suddenly. Masses and masses, some of them admirals, generals, even field marshals, privates, everybody all corralled there together. It was an odd feeling that of all this enormous power having laid down its arms and standing there before us, feeling this formidable machine was there just like a whole mass of sheep in the field, you know, defenseless and unarmed, ready to do our bidding. It was very heightened by the sense, of course, that the Germans were probably a more professional and better trained army, really, than we were. And there they all were, sort of before us.
Now the Allies drove eastward, and the special coverage unit set its sights on being in the right place to cover the link-up between the Americans and the Russian army that was approaching from the east. They headed for Torgau on the Elbe River.
This is Frank Gillard at General Bradley's headquarters. East and west have met. At 20 minutes to 5 on Wednesday afternoon, April the 25th, 1945, American troops of General Bradley's 12th Army Group made contact with Soviet elements of Marshal Konev's 1st Ukrainian Army Group near the German town of Torgau on the Elbe.
Their journeys had started a world apart, yet the Stevens Irregulars and their Russian counterparts seemed like old friends. the Stevens unit received urgent orders to move south through Germany to Bavaria. At the Dachau concentration camp, what they saw and recorded would not soon be forgotten.
This is a 20-year-old young man with a sheltered life behind him. It was a terrible shock. How can one human being do this to another human being? Impossible to think of. How does one justify this mass murder? You just want to hate the Germans. You want to hate all Germans at this time.
Some German guards had disguised themselves in the striped uniforms of the prisoners. Working with recently freed inmates, the liberators sought to identify the Germans. SS guards were shot. Others were beaten to death by enraged inmates. An epidemic struck the camp, and the freed prisoners were sprayed with DDT to prevent further deaths. After years of horror and degradation, the time had come for Dachau's first religious service. On May 8th, 10 days after the liberation of Dachau, came the news that the world had long awaited.
Good morning from the White House in Washington. President of the United States.
The Western world has been freed of the evil forces which for 5 years and longer have imprisoned the bodies and broken the lives of millions upon millions of freeborn men. The flags of freedom fly all over Europe.
A 1.5 million men had been held as prisoners of war in Germany. Now, warriors from many Allied nations were free, and they were going home. As spring came to Europe in 1945, it seemed the entire continent was on the move.
The whole of Europe was like some enormous crossroads, dusty crossroads, dust from all the vehicles churning up the roads. And in the green of the spring was this dust and this constant stream. Of all the men of Europe going home, mostly on foot, pushing perambulators and carts, Norwegians going north, Italians going south, Belgians and French going west, people going back to Russia and Poland, everywhere people passing each other on these endless, endless crossroads of Europe.
Fighting over, my father's curiosity drew him east to the Bavarian Alps, to Berchtesgaden. There they would inspect Hitler's mountain hideaway with its tea rooms and terraces and its famous picture window.
I captured most of Hitler's dinnerware up there, and I took it back to Paris and traded it for cognac, so an awful lot of Hitler's dinnerware is around Paris somewhere.
Finally, they received clearance from the Russians to go to Berlin. The German capital had been liberated by the Russian army, and Stalin had made it clear that the Soviet Union would not be dislodged from Berlin or Eastern Germany.
The Russians were very systematic about cleaning up the city. Like, they'd take the block, and somebody who wasn't a true Nazi, they'd made him the boss. And they'd form endless lines, and they'd take these bricks and pass them one to the other. And that's the way they cleaned up.
They were absolutely beaten. Most of them were wandering around in a daze. They were more afraid of the Russians than they were of the Allies.
Now Berlin was divided into Soviet, British, French, and American occupation zones. The fragile Allied unity had come to an end, and the Cold War was about to begin. The Stevens Irregulars were coming to the end of their time as soldiers. Their last days were spent viewing the remnants of the Third Reich, the Reich's chancellery where Hitler plotted his war. And the trench where his and his mistress Eva Braun's bodies were burned. They saw the stadium where in 1936 Hitler first found the world spotlight and a platform for his idea of a master race. Their work was done. They had recorded history. Now their thoughts turned to home, to their families, and to resuming their careers as filmmakers and storytellers. Each of the Stevens Irregulars was affected by the war, and for many of them, their war experience would color their work. In 1948, Irwin Shaw published the acclaimed World War II novel, The Young Lions. Captain Joe Byrock returned to Hollywood and photographed the film classic, It's a Wonderful Life. Ivan Moffat wrote screenplays for Tender is the Night and Giant. William Meller won Academy Awards as director of photography for A Place in the Sun and The Diary of Anne Frank. George Stevens turned from comedies, musicals, and adventure to create American classics like A Place in the Sun, Shane, Giant, and The Diary of Anne Frank.
Ivan Moffat told me of the day in May 1945 when they left the concentration camp at Dachau. My father asked the driver to stop the jeep by a building on the edge of the camp. It was the post office where all mail had come and gone for so many painful years. He disappeared inside and came back 10 minutes later, and they drove off in silence. After a time, Ivan asked, "Why did you go in there?" Dad reached in his pocket and handed this to him. It is the stamp that was used to mark the letters in the Dachau post office. The adjustable date still shows April the 29th, 1945. The day the Allies liberated the camp, and the day the atrocity stopped forever.
You know, there was this enormous question, what do you do with all of this? Well, what we did principally was to give it to the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences, and it forms the George Stevens Collection, which is one of the best collections of any film director. And among that collection was this footage. And their job was to photograph the war in black and white, and they had those 35 millimeter small cameras and bigger cameras that you saw in the film. But my father had taken along the 16 millimeter camera that he had used to shoot behind the scenes footage on Gunga Din. And I was in a restaurant in Los Angeles about 3 or 4 years ago, and a fellow came up to me and introduced himself. And he said, "You know, I was in London during World War II, just before D-Day, and I ran into your father, and I said, would you like to take some color film along?" And Dad said, "Sure." So he said, I gave him these crates of color film. So it was really, as a hobby or as a personal little biography of home movies, that they were shooting this color film, which then sat in that storeroom for nearly 40 years. And I think by the time I came on to it, it was kind of much more valuable and intriguing than if it had been something that, you know, 3 years after the war you would have unveiled. So that was just by way of a little introduction.
Well, how much footage altogether was there, both the black and official black and white footage and the unofficial color footage?
There's about 4 hours of it, or 4 or 5 hours, and I gave it all to the Library of Congress. It's now in the Library of Congress, and people are able to use it. Documentarians the world over are always asking for it, and because I really felt it belonged in the public domain. Mm-hmm.
And you show us at the end of the film the Dachau postmark. Do you still have that, or what's become of that?
I have that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then just one other collectible question. Any idea what happened to the Jeep, Toluca?
No, I think that it probably is in the graveyard of the hundreds of thousands or millions of Jeeps. We lived in a little place in North Hollywood called Toluca Lake, and that is the reason for the Jeep being called Toluca.
Mm-hmm. You say in the film, in your narration, I remember my father saying August 25th, 1944 was the greatest day of his life. Did he talk about the war with you much, both when you were a boy and then later when you worked together?
Yes, he talked about the war a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And much of it was kind of storyteller memories. He had a great gift for storytelling. And the voice with the English accent that you hear is Ivan Moffat, who was an American raised in England and drafted into the American Army and assigned to my father's unit. And he rode in my father's Jeep through most of the war. And then he was a beautifully educated, brilliant young man. And then he came back to Los Angeles and went to work for my father and worked with him through most of his pictures after the war. And Ivan was the best man at my wedding.
Mm-hmm.
And Ivan, too, would always talk of that day. In watching this, every time you watch a film, you see kind of new things in it. And I think my father must have been 36 when he went into the service, and he was well beyond draft age and had a son. I mean, he was...
You didn't have to do it.
Exactly. And I had these feelings, of course, for all of them. You know, those men we saw in the gliders that were going to parachute over the Rhine, but that, you know, these people who spent that time over there, and, you know, it occurred to me, looking at my father, and, you know, in the mud and the grit and all of that, that I just had, you could just sense he had no wish to be anywhere else. You know, he could have been on a soundstage with, you know, making pictures with Irene Dunne, but, you know, it was clearly where he wanted to be. And you get a sense of really, I think, of the great adventure that must have been. You know, when you see them looking at the surrendering Germans, for those of us who are old enough to remember the mood of World War II, the fear that the German army struck in people, the Panzer divisions, and, you know, this was the mightiest army ever put together. And here are these sort of American GIs, draftees, have turned the tide. It's quite remarkable.
Well, you were 10, 12, 13 during the war. How vivid are your own memories of it? I mean, were you concerned about your father? Was he constantly writing home?
Yes, we had in his collection the wonderful letters. He sent me emails, and he kept the letters that I sent him and my mother sent, and vice versa. One of a treasured item I have, when you ask how we felt, I don't know if you remember a film called The Human Comedy, which Mickey Rooney played as a boy, the delivery boy for Western Union. And I haven't seen it in many, many years, but there was kind of the drunk that ran the Western Union office, and he'd give Mickey Rooney these telegrams to take to notify mothers and husbands, I mean, and wives, that their son or husband had been killed in battle. And there was that. We had a star in our window, and there was always that thought, is the Western Union man going to come to your door? And I received a package, it must have been sometime shortly after D-Day, and unwrapped it, and it was a copy of The Human Comedy. And it's inscribed with the most eloquent, Saroyan-esque inscription. About, and it's dated June the 2nd, 1944, So they both knew they were going to a different place, and he writes to a 12-year-old just the way you would think of Saroyan writing. He said, you know, when I'm in your father's world, I'm in a better world, and this kind of romantic and affectionate, and that we have a great adventure ahead of us. And of course, Saroyan was part of that unit, and as you pointed out, in one of those later scenes at the very end, the person having a cognac across the table from my father is Robert Capa.
In Berlin.
In Berlin. And then, of course, you saw Irwin Shaw. It was quite a collection of irregulars.
He kept good company.
Yes.
Do you remember you mentioned at the beginning, sending home the packages of color film. Do you remember them coming in the mail?
I don't think I do at the time,
yeah.
But they were addressed now that I can look at the boxes, some are addressed to our house, 4300 Foreman mm-hmm. Avenue, North Hollywood, and others were addressed to Lieutenant Colonel Frank Capra, who had his photo unit in Culver City.
Well, it's one of the great truisms of Hollywood history that the war had a profound effect on your father, and you imply this at the end. As many people, I'm sure, remember, he made a number of marvelous light films before the war, Swing Time, the Astaire Rogers musical, Gunga Din, as you mentioned, the great classic adventure film, The More the Merrier, that wonderful comedy. And then after the war, the belief is, the conventional wisdom, that the war affected him, he became much more serious, and he made films like Shane and A Place in the Sun. The Diary of Anne Frank. Do you think that's true? Is that too simplistic? Did the war affect him that much? Did it affect his art that much?
Well, the war did affect him. It's a convenience for critics and people who want to try and get to the truth of things. He certainly didn't lose his humor. He directed one sequence in a picture without credit. The picture was called On Our Merry Way, and it was one of those sketch pictures with three or four mm-hmm. segments. And he did a piece with Jimmy Fonda, Jimmy Stewart and Henry Fonda, which is so funny. Mm-hmm. I mean, he had the ability to do funny stories, but I think his interests, he was a different person, and his interests were deeper. It was less a loss of humor than enlarged understanding about the world and different things to express.
And in fact, you worked with your father towards the beginning of your career and along towards the end of his. What was that experience like?
Well, I worked with him. My first job in life was one summer. Had two assignments. One was to break down Theodore Dreiser's An American Tragedy, meaning list every scene and sequence and character.
Which, of course, is the basis for A Place in the Sun, the Elizabeth Taylor Montgomery Clift classic.
Right. Yeah. And the other was to read books that came from the studio and scripts. And as I look back at it now and have raised and have nurtured my own sons, I realize now that it was probably a little more of a make-work project than mm-hmm. the fact that he thought I was going to have any particular insight into whether these scripts that came from the studio were any good. But I did read a book that came, and I went one night to, and it was in his bedroom. He was in bed reading, and I came over and I said, I think this is really, this is an interesting story. I think you ought to read it. And he, again, now I now perceive it, the cultivation motive. He said, why don't you tell me the story? It was on my assignment. I walked around this bedroom trying to tell him the story of Shane. Of course, he made the story into really a classic film and saw much more in it than his 16 or 17-year-old son did.
Well, even if it was a make-work job, I think it's fair to say you earned your salary.
Yes, thank you.
Well, how do you think, your father is one of the master filmmakers. We've mentioned various mm-hmm. classic films he made. if you could somehow set the time machine and bring him to Hollywood today at the height of his powers, how do you think he would fare there now?
Well, he would, you know, I'm sure whatever hand was he was dealt, he would play very well. It's hard for me. It's too tough a question. So I'll dodge it and
sure.
give you a kind of a related answer. I'm finishing a book which is called The Great Movie Makers of the Golden Age, Conversations at the American Film Institute. I've edited seminars that we did with great filmmakers, starting with Harold Lloyd, King Vidor, Raoul Walsh, my father, Weiler Wilder, Houston, Hitchcock, and on. And in the introduction to it, I write of how I think for so many of these people, the Second World War gave them a second act. It's hard to know what kind of films they would have gone on to make. John Huston, John Ford, George Stevens, William Wyler, had it not been that they saw combat. And ironically, Frank Capra, who was also a colonel and was the first to go into the service but stayed in Culver City heading, you know, Frank didn't see war and had trouble after the, mm-hmm. you know, he had a harder time finding a second act. So I think, you know, I can't see any of these men ever having made American Graffiti, you know, or, you know, films that kind of serious filmmakers, George Lucas has gone on to be a very accomplished, but, you know, they were, and I knew them, John Huston, my father, Ford, Wyler. They were serious people and wanted to do serious work.
Well, let me ask that question in a different way that might be easier to answer. In a sense, through your father, you've been exposed to Hollywood almost back to the silent era, right down to the present. You're still a working producer and involved in the industry. Is it possible for you to say what, over that time, has been the single biggest or the several biggest changes in the industry?
The biggest change, as it affects what's happening in film today, is that for whatever reasons, whether it's that conglomerates now can control the filmmaking process, or that some people are finding their entertainment at home video or DVDs, but all of the financial interest of the motion picture industry right now is directed at making films that will attract 18 to 24-year-old males. Mm-hmm. And it's very hard to get the kind of films that the men I've been referring to made today. I mean, you look at what's coming out. You know, week after week, it's, you know, Batman, Mr. and Mrs. Smith. They're, you know, it's designed for that audience, and it really kind of excludes the adult audience. Mm-hmm.
Do you hold out any hope for the future, or?
I do. I think that people will find a way. I mean, I guess what I don't like about it is, I think that it's become a magnet taking promising filmmakers like the ones who, you know, did Batman and Mr. and Mrs. Smith, and they're getting drawn into this vortex of making these puffed up, you know, $100 million pictures that have to score in a certain way. But I think that creative people will continue to find ways to make important films. Even if it is only for HBO.
Mm-hmm. To get back to your father again, did he ever talk to you about what he was proudest of? He had such a varied career, including his documentary work during the war and these many films. Was there any one thing that meant the most to him? Or?
Yeah, he didn't really talk that way. Mm-hmm. But I guess being around somebody, you can pick up. I don't know whether I'm speaking for myself or for him when I say I think he would probably have valued his integrity, that he kind of did the right thing professionally and personally in kind of the choices he made in terms of making films, the choice to go to war, the choice in a story that's too long to get into, but during the McCarthy period when DeMille and Ronald Reagan and the right in Hollywood wanted to oust that president of the Directors Guild, it was Dad who took them on and stemmed the tide, as it were. So he made a lot of good choices. And, you know, I think he, Shane is, you know, was kind of part of the West that he cared about. The Diary of Anne Frank was important to him. It was, he called it his war film. He never made a real war film. And, of course, that was a great experience because he and I worked together on that. I was involved in the, he asked me to, I'd gone on and was directing television, Alfred Hitchcock and Peter Gunn and shows like that. And he came to me and said, would you like to come back and work with me on The Diary of Anne Frank? And I became his associate producer. And at the end, when he got very far behind schedule, he asked me to go, and I shot all of the footage in Amsterdam, all the location footage that he had intended to shoot. So it was a wonderful collaboration. And to connect it a little bit to our experience tonight, in the preparation of it, he and I went to Dachau. It was the first time he'd been to Europe since the war. And you know, that was just a very moving experience. I had not seen this film at the time, but for him to go back there, and you can just imagine what you've seen and returning to that place. And then we went to Normandy and went did the beach, went on to the beaches and the graveyard. And I remember Dad had a, you know, kind of a light touch. And you pick up, you know, the terminology of the war. Those guys kept using it. And we drove through the town of Caen in Normandy, and it had a lot of kind of modern buildings. And Dad said to me, yeah, we touched Caen up pretty good. And, of course, that was the town you saw that was just so devastated. So, and then we went from there, we went to Amsterdam and went one morning to a little office in the town of Amsterdam to meet Otto Frank, Anne Frank's father. And he was a remarkable man, tall, straight, gray hair, I mean balding but with gray hair. He had been in the German army in the First World War as a German officer, and then during the Hitler time finally fled to Amsterdam and started this spice business. And it was above their little spice factory that the Frank family and another family hid. And Mr. Frank greeted us, served us coffee in this modest little office. And then he went to a filing cabinet and pulled open this filing cabinet and took a package out and unwrapped it, wrapped in paper, and put in front of us this little plaid book that was his daughter's diary. And he wanted to help in any way he could to make this film of her life be true. And we went from there with his wife. He had lost his wife and two daughters at Belsen. He had been in Auschwitz. And he had subsequently married a woman, Fritzi, who had lost her family. And so he and his present wife took us to the Prinzenkracht on the canal, which is where we shot the exteriors, if you've seen The Diary of Anne Frank. And he took us up into that building. And it was so moving to go up. And I don't know if he'd been up there recently, and that he wanted us to know, and he told us about the day the Germans came and how they lived. And you know, that's one of the, when you ask what's important in my father's life, there are so many, you know, kind of rich experiences, but for both of us to work together and to be part of that piece of history. And Dad realized in the course of this that he had been 60 miles from where they were hiding at the time of the Battle of the Bulge. I mean, this kind of small world of, you know, a 36-year-old guy who'd never left the United States is suddenly, you know, at Bastogne, not that far from Amsterdam.
We're talking about your father, of course. What was it like for your mother during the war? Was it a real wrench for her to have him go? Was she fully supportive of it?
I guess so. I don't think, I mean, you know, it's not, you know, for me to talk about the sacrifice of our family. I mean, my father came back, you know, he had his experience, you know, so many millions served, so many thousands died, and so many people were in that situation that my mother was in. Sure, she was a woman alone raising a boy, but she was a nurse's aide. I mean, you know, people coped.
Mm-hmm. Since we are at the Kennedy Library,
and I should note that July 31st, I'll be going to Los Angeles for my mother's 100th birthday.
Let's hope you get her genes.
Yeah.
You worked in the government during the Kennedy administration,
yes.
And we were talking before the screening that, in fact, you met President Kennedy. Might you talk a little bit about him and your experiences of
it? I'd be pleased to. And sitting in this theater brings to mind that I had been involved in the planning for this library. I had gone to work for Edward R. Murrow, who was running the USIA for President Kennedy. And, after the events of November 1963, and I had become close with, you know, many of, you know, in the administration and the Kennedy family, when the planning for the, you know, what was to be done for the Kennedy Library, there was the Mrs. Kennedy, Jacqueline, was very involved, and Bill Walton, a great friend of the president's, an artist who was also a World War II colleague of my father's in Europe. And one of my kind of pushes was that they should incorporate film, that it was a real opportunity to use film to tell the story, like no previous presidential library. And I was, one of my little missions was persuading Mr. Pei, that I am Pei, that we needed a film theater, and I think we're sitting in it.
And in fact, you went on to do one of the most celebrated documentaries about President Kennedy, which Deborah mentioned at the beginning. Might you talk a little bit about that?
Yes. First of all, that was such a great experience to be part of that. And Ed Murrow had come to me. I was involved with my father on his next picture, and Ed asked me to come and run the motion picture division of USIA, and I first said no, I couldn't, because I just felt I couldn't let my father down. We were like partners by then. And a few days later, I mentioned something about Ed Murrow and told my father, and Dad said, I think you have to do it. And he saw that for me it would be a life-changing experience. And again, in the ethical world he lived in, that my life was more important than his at that point.
Did his path ever cross Murrow's when they were in London?
I think just not closely, mm-hmm. but they, of course, knew of one another. And it was a great experience working with, and I had come to Washington, and I was invited as a bachelor. You got some good invitations, too, that Shriver's, Sergeant Shriver, who was then head of the Peace Corps, and Eunice, President Kennedy's sister. And I went out as black tie, wonderful sit-down dinner, and I remember I met Newton Minow at dinner.
Head of the FCC,
the vast wasteland, and we had a lot to talk about. And afterwards, we were having drinks. It was when they used to pass scotches and cognac. They don't do that anymore after dinner. And winter night, I remember I'd driven out in a little car, rental car, and wasn't used to driving in the snow. And the front door blew open, it seemed. And then, coatless, walked the President of the United States. You know, and it was before you saw, it was before color television. And, you know, now you see somebody on television, you think you know them. You know, if you run into Larry King, you think, God, oh, yeah, I know you. But it was just seeing a president in color was somehow struck me. And he kind of walked around the circle of people, and he came within 2 or 3 feet of me, and it was that was great, you know. And then I'm standing talking to Minow, and I'm going on about something, and Minow said, have you met the president? And I said, no, I haven't met the president. And then I realized it was not a, and I look around, and he introduces me to President Kennedy. And he starts to say, Ed Murrow has asked George to come back and make the motion picture. And President Kennedy said, I know about that. And I said, there's something I want to talk to you about. To me, you know, Jesus, you know. And then, but first, he said, and then he said, Minow, he said, this is so typical of President Kennedy. They had just broadcast, if it's CBS or NBC, Jacqueline Kennedy's tour of the White House. And he looked at Minow, he said, how come CBS didn't broadcast Jackie's tour of the White House in color? They made $450 million last year, and they can't afford to broadcast it in color. But it was so typical Kennedy. And what it turned, and then he was being taken away, he said, I'll be in touch with you. And what he wanted to talk to me about was PT-109, which was then in the process of becoming a movie, and he thought I might have some advice. And so then I had the privilege of working with him, and you know, saw him on many occasions. And you, now we're doing Kennedy Library stuff. This is not about D-Day to Berlin, but since we're on that tack, I'm sure much of the lore or the history in this place is about how President Kennedy inspired the people in his administration. And there were the stories that the desk officer for Haiti would be at his office, and the phone would ring, and it's President Kennedy. He didn't want to ask Dean Rusk to ask the assistant secretary for Latin America. You know, he liked it. And it had the effect, and I don't think any of his cabinet officers minded it, because it had the effect of just lifting an organization, a department, you know, that he appreciates what we're doing and is interested and knows that individuals are doing it. And there were several occasions where once I was in the Murrow's meeting of all of his area directors and media directors, and my deputy comes and hands me a note, and it's President Kennedy's on the phone, you know, calling. So I excuse myself, and he takes my place, and I go down and pick the phone. It's Mrs. Lincoln. And I said, just a minute, I'll put the president on. Hey, George, he said, I saw this film, The Five Cities of June, Saturday night. I said, that's the best government documentary I've seen. He said, where's it being shown? I said, well, it's over how many countries? You know, he kept overlapping my dialogue with successive questions. He was ahead of me. But there was that interest that he took in. And I remember, I guess that this will be the end of this passage, but I was in California one time, and being single and wayward, I'd stay out very late at night, and one morning about 7 o'clock, the phone rang, and I was having a hard time getting away. It was my assistant in my office in Washington. He said, President Kennedy just called, and I, Mrs. Lincoln, I gave her the number there. He's going to be calling you. So, God, I'm trying to get awake, and do I have time to splash water on my face? And I just go, and the phone rings, and I said, I can't go splash water on my face and let the phone ring if it's the president. I answer the phone, and she puts President Kennedy on. He said, now, have you entered the Five Cities of June in the Academy Awards?
As I want to ask one more Kennedy question, but as those of you who are familiar with the Kennedy Library forums know, the program will consist the first half of discussions here and then questions from the audience. So while I'm asking my last question, if anyone does have a question of their own, there's a microphone there, and if you'd like to head over there, you can ask Mr. Stevens your own questions. This is a question that you may be uniquely qualified to answer as one who had dealings with President Kennedy and who grew up at the epicenter of Hollywood. Did he have star power? Obviously, he was a master politician, but we often hear about his charisma. He was such a good-looking man. Did he have that extra certain something when he came through that room, when the door blew open?
Yeah, it was magical. He was just, I mean, you look at these pictures in the lobby of him as a young Navy lieutenant. He had it. He was had charm, intelligence, curiosity, and energy.
And we already have some people lined up, so, sir?
Mr. Stevens, for the 40 years that this film sat in your father's, did you know what was in there? Did he, you know, mention the Dachau film while he was making Anne Frank, or did he talk to you about the birthday present opening? Did you have any idea what was there?
No, not the birthday present. We did talk about the Dachau footage. At one time, there was a famous lawyer in San Francisco called Vincent Hallinan, who I think even ran for president on the socialist ticket or something, but he was a great, brilliant Clarence Darrow, Edward Bennett Williams defense attorney, and he and Dad were friends. And Hallinan was there one time, and Dad told me that they took out this film because he wanted to show it to him, the Dachau footage, and they ran 5 minutes of it, and Dad said, I just can't look at this. I can't go back. So I had wanted to show, and I'd asked him, because I knew of the liberation of Paris, and Bill Walton, who I mentioned earlier, wanted to see it, and we wanted to run it for President Kennedy. And while that was, you know, with all things came, you know, the November of 63 came before we got around to that. But I really didn't have any detailed knowledge of it. And just to mention the birthday footage, you can imagine how moving that was when I came upon it. But I was watching it tonight, and what's that expression? You can't make it up. Here he is by his Jeep, the Toluca. You know, I mean, a movie director's life, you know, in combat with the guys, and they decide to open their Christmas presents with snow on the Jeep and take pictures of it. Movie style. And if you notice at the end, he points up and there's a German dive bomber has come, and they get in the car and drive off. You can't make it up. Sir.
Yes, while I was watching the credits of the film flow by, it struck me that part of the significance of this film is that you couldn't afford to put together a staff of movie makers like that were represented in this film.
No.
A question I have is that I was about your age when this film was shot, and my recollection was that during World War II, on the home front, we were fed a very sugar-coated version of World War II. And I was wondering, did you ever talk to your father about that? Is my recollection wrong, first place? And were they under direction not to show much of the horror that was reflected in this film?
That's a good question. I'm trying to remember. I think there were some rules. I never discussed it with my father, but I've read about it, that I think we were not supposed to, they didn't show much of dead American soldiers, if I recall. They'd give you a sense in the newsreel theaters when we'd go to the, as I'm sure you did, you know, they'd have the News View Theater on Hollywood Boulevard. My mother and I would go down, and you'd have an hour of newsreels. And I'm sure people all across this country went to those looking to see if they were going to see their husband or brother or father in the footage. And I just never discussed with him. And he really had not much sense of you know, how the film was seen back home. He made the choice. He said, I didn't want to be somewhere in an editing room cutting together war documentaries. And in a letter he wrote to my mother about the liberation of Paris, he just expressed that exhilaration. And he said, I know we hadn't changed our clothes for 2 weeks. And he said we had a ride that day, referring to the great stunt man Yakima Canutt. He said that Yakima Canutt would have earned $200 for the ride into Paris.
So they would shoot the footage and then just send it off to the Signal Corps or wherever?
Yeah, you'd see them wrapping it up, and it would come back, and then it would be edited. Much of it exists today in that there were two newsreel primary companies in the day, Fox Movie Tone and Hearst Metrotone. One was MGM and one was 20th Century Fox, and they would make the newsreels and put them in theaters.
Yes.
I'm just curious about a detail of that those cartons of Kodachrome. I grew up as a kid. My dad had a 16-millimeter mm-hmm. film camera, and we had pictures of his Victory Garden and us as kids and so on in color. And were those films sent home not processed, and they just languished for a long time, or were they processed and nobody wanted to look at them? Or
you know what I think happened, now that you mention it? The way it worked was you would buy a box of film, and they were cassettes, and then you would put it in your Cine Special, expose it, you would put it back in the box and send it to Kodak, that same piece of film, it's called Reversal,
right.
And it has tremendous quality. I mean, that's, you know, this video is not a pure representation of it, but it is so vivid, the quality. So I think what was probably done is that it was sent to Kodak, and then our address was the send-back address. And I hadn't thought of that before, but I think that's the answer.
So, and your father really never did want to see any of those reels?
Not really, no. No, I think while you were interested in it, you didn't want to look back. I think he kept it if he was making a certain kind of a war film one day, that he would use it. And I think that Steven Spielberg and Janusz Kaminski, his cinematographer, really went to school on it for Ryan's daughter.
Saving Private Ryan.
Saving Private Ryan.
Ryan's daughter.
I would never accuse David Lean.
But one thing that did strike me, as a somewhat younger person who's, you know, digital and all, the richness of the color is just extraordinary.
Yeah, it's that Kodak color is the best. There's been no better film made. But,
yes. Believe it or not, that was going to be my question. The footage looked a lot like Saving Private Ryan, and then also the HBO series Band of Brothers. It's in that very grainy footage, and I was wondering if they had ever consulted with you or saw the footage.
Yeah, Steven asked to get the whole batch of it, and I arranged for him to get it, and I'm sure that because he was involved in Band of Brothers as well, and so I think the answer is yes.
Yes. Hi, I just have two factual questions. I kind of lost track of how long he was there, how many months or.
Well, my father left. In early 1943, first in North Africa,
right.
And then the preparations. So they went in on D-Day, which was June the 6th of 1944, and I think he got back early in 46. He went to Nuremberg preparing materials for the Nuremberg trials. So he was gone about 3 years.
And also, is there footage of North Africa then that was not?
Yes. It's in the Library of Congress. That it is, and it goes to the question that the previous man asked, they were reenacting tank scenes in North Africa. In other words, it was after the battle. And that's how, there was a great film called Desert Victory that the British did. So it was kind of a custom that you could reenact and create to tell a story. And that, as television and news have taken over, that's really become not acceptable.
And the other question is, what was the name of the place where all the German, the largest number of Germans had surrendered, 320,000, whatever, what was the name of that?
You know, I'm not sure.
I know I'm gonna.
No, Torgau was later. That was where they linked up with the Russians, and I just don't know. No, Nordhausen was not where the Germans, or that was the. Does anybody know?
Go to World War II. 340,000Germans.com.
And themselves. You guys are a great audience. Thank you.
Thank you, George Stevens, Jr.